Yeah, you would help a bunch.
Good morning. So good to see us all together. One service. The first song we're singing this morning is Praise You with the Dance. Now, it's an upbeat song, and it's meant to lift our attention and our spirits up towards God. And as we praise Him with our voices, if you want to sway a little bit like Chris, you can do that. We please like you to join us in singing through the whole service. So please stand and join us.
I will sing to the Lord, and I will lift my voice, for you have heard my cry. I will sing to the Lord, I will lift my hands, for you have brought me out of the pit, for you have brought me out of the pit. I'll sing glory, hallelujah, lift your name on high. I'll sing holy, cause you're worthy, praise. sing holy, cause you're worthy. I'll praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance. I will sing to the Lord, and I will lift my voice, for you have heard my cry. I will sing to the Lord, I will lift my hands, for you have brought me out of the pit, for you have brought me out of the pit. I'll sing glory, hallelujah, lift your name on high. I'll sing holy, cause you're worthy, praise you with the dance. I'll sing hallelujah, lift your name on high. I'll sing holy, cause you're worthy. I'll praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance. I'll sing glory, hallelujah, lift your name on high. I'll sing holy, cause you're worthy. I'll praise you with the dance. I'll sing glory, hallelujah, lift your name on high. I'll sing holy, cause you're worthy. I'll praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance. I will praise you with the dance.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, it's good to see a full church again. Let's take a moment, and as you're comfortable, greet one another. Morning. Morning. Good morning. Good to see you guys. Morning, Doris. Morning. Morning, Paul. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. 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 Morning, Shirley. Good to see you. Morning, Richard. Good to see you. Morning, Daryl. We worship this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus reminded the disciples. Jesus taught and witnessed to God's love. Jesus encourages us to love each other with tenderness, compassion, and hope. Let us take a moment for silent prayer and confession with God. Gathered together in God's presence, let us confess our sin against God and one another. Mighty and loving God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We seek our own way. We divide the body of Christ. In your mercy, cleanse us and heal us. Let the words of our mouths and the thoughts of our hearts and everything we do in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sin. Blessed are you. Rejoice and be glad, beloved people of God. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our teacher and guide, you draw us to yourself and welcome us as beloved children. Help us to lay aside all envy and selfish ambition, that we may walk in your ways of wisdom and understanding as servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 54. Save me, O God, by your name.
And vindicate me by your might.
Hear my prayer, O God. For the insolent have risen against me, the ruthless seek my life.
They do not set God before them.
But surely God is my helper.
The Lord is the upholder of my life.
He will repay my enemies for their evil. With a free will offering I will sacrifice to you. For he has delivered me from every trouble.
First reading is from Jeremiah chapter 11, verses 18 through 20. Today's reading tells of the suffering of the prophet Jeremiah, who announced God's word to Judah, but was met with intense opposition and persecution. Jeremiah continues to trust in God in the midst of his suffering. The reading begins. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew then that you showed me their evil deeds, but I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. And I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from James, starting with the third chapter, starting with the 13th verse. The wisdom God gives unites our hearts and minds. Instead of living to satisfy our own wants and desires, we manifest this wisdom in peace, gentleness, mercy, and impartiality towards others. The reading begins. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness, born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and you do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. The word of our Lord.
We cried out,
ten mighty one. With one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice, that you would reign, that you would reign in us.
Please rise for the gospel. The gospel for this 17th Sunday after Pentecost is written in St. Mark, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 30th verse. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus' teaching and action in this text are directed to the church, where whenever it is seduced by the world's definition of greatness, prestige, power, influence, money. The antidote to such a concern for greatness is servanthood. The gospel reads, Jesus and the disciples went on and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, the Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again. They did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, what were you arguing about on the way? But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. The gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. I'd like to invite the young people, children, up for a children's message. Hey guys, you can just sit right down here. It's been so long since we've had one that it's great to see you here. We got a few coming along, straggling. So have you guys ever argued about something? Have you ever argued with someone about something? Have you? Yeah, probably quite a bit with your brothers and sisters and stuff. Yeah, it does happen, doesn't it? And what kind of things do you argue about? Do you ever argue about who is the greatest or who's the best? No? Really? How about what are some of the things you argue about? When I was a kid, we always, I didn't have any brothers or sisters, but when we got together with other kids, one of the things that we argued about was whose dad or mom or whose family was the best, or whose car was the fastest or things like that, silly things like that. Who had the best car? Was a Pontiac better than a Chevy? And you don't even know what a Pontiac is, do you, anymore? We used to argue about silly things like that and think that, you know, whatever we had was the best and whatever we did was the greatest. And today Jesus is talking with his disciples and he heard them as they were walking along the road. He heard them kind of discussing or talking about some things among themselves. And other, we're going to look at this story today, if you can kind of gather around maybe a little closer. It's a story about who's the greatest. Certainly it's not my microphone. Okay. So it says, I'm the best. And then one said, no, I'm the best. You're not the best, I am. And the disciples were arguing and they walked along the road. They didn't know that Jesus heard them. Why are you arguing? Asked Jesus. What are you saying? The disciples' faces turned bright red. They looked down at the ground. No one said anything. They knew it was wrong to argue about being the best. See the disciples there? And Jesus stopped, sat down, and invited his disciples to sit down with him. He lifted up a child onto his lap. If you want to be the greatest and serve everyone and help everyone, Jesus told them, this child believes in God and can serve others. It doesn't matter how big or how strong or how smart or anything like that you are. Anyone can serve and help others if he or she tries. Then you're truly great. So instead of arguing about, you know, who was the best or who had the best bike or car or anything like that, or whose dad was the toughest, Jesus calls us to serve others, to help others, to be kind and compassionate. And that's the way Jesus feels that we are truly doing good things for him and that we will be the best. So when you start thinking about, when you see someone else and you think, oh, I can do better than that, or I'm better than that, you can think, oh, no, wait, maybe I should help that person, or maybe there's something I can do to make things better somewhere. And that's what Jesus calls us to do, to be kind and to love others and to help others. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you for loving us, and we pray that you would help us to love others as you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, and remember, after service today, there's the Sunday school kickoff in God's Acres, so you can all go out there, and I'm sure you will have a good time. All right, we'll see. You can go back to your folks. So as we learned, the disciples were caught in an embarrassing situation. They were curious, those disciples. Jesus had healed a blind man. He had predicted his own suffering and death, which Peter took issue to. And later, they witnessed the transfiguration of Jesus on Mount Tabor with Moses and Elijah. They saw him heal an epileptic child, and they spent quite a bit of time with Jesus as he taught them and shared with them things about the kingdom of God. Now, on the heels of his second passion prediction of his suffering and death, the disciples must have been either distracted or maybe even a little bit overwhelmed. In any case, they began talking amongst themselves. Maybe they kind of blew it off. And then later on, when they were in Capernaum, Jesus hit them with that question. What were you talking about? And that's when they were caught. They didn't know what to say. But Jesus knew what that issue was. And he sat them down to gently teach them about servanthood and the kingdom of God. He held that little child, and he said, "Whoever welcomes a child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Again, that is a radical move, because children were not very prominent those days. They were to be seen and not heard. But for Jesus, he was getting at some important things. One of my professors, Don Jewell, stated that the image of a child may symbolize all those within the Christian family. All the people within the Christian family. Things were much different for children than they were for us today. While receiving, welcoming, and caring for children was important, children were without status in the ancient world. So to welcome a child as an important person was a big change. And Jesus said to welcome a child is akin to welcoming him and God. Here's another way that Jesus is turning the world upside down. He's overturning those social customs, giving importance to those who previously had no status or power. So the rub for those disciples comes with the fact that they were arguing among themselves about who was the greatest. Just as we talked about in the children's message, we argue about silly things sometimes as well. Jesus is saying that the societal norms of everyday life are not what is important to God. God is concerned with those of low social status, the poor, the powerless, the outcast, the sinners, children. The kingdom of God is open to all people, always, welcoming those who have previously been on the outside looking in is what is most important to God. Power, prestige, control, social standing, that's not important to God. That's not what God's all about. We have an interesting parallel in our second lesson today. The book of James, though it is one of my favorites, is not generally thought of as being really well respected in Lutheran circles. It tends to focus more on what we do as Christians rather than on what God has done for us. So today's lesson, however, reminds us of the root cause of our problems and struggles as humans. The writer uses the conflicts and the disputes that we have as examples of how our sinful human cravings and desires have really put a separation between us and God. The root cause is that we let our own desires become a catalyst for our disagreements. We tend to think a little more highly of our own importance than we need to. And we all fall into the trap that the disciples fell into, wanting to be the greatest. These things are usually not a lot more subtle than they were in the gospel. And Jesus, or James, really hits us the nail on the head for us. We're challenged to think of ourselves with all of the social standing of a little child, to humble ourselves before God our Father. James calls on us to submit ourselves to God, to resist evil, whereupon the devil will flee from us. James is calling us to draw near to God. That could be where our Lutheran understanding of God's action in Christ comes into play. I would challenge us to remember that relationships are not a one-way street. Relationships are not a one-way street. We know that God is waiting like a father waits in the story of the prodigal son to welcome all his people into his arms. There's always room to draw closer to God and God's love. God never moves away from us, but in our attempts to control our own destinies, to make our own ways in the world, and to make our mark on society, we can let that relationship with God slide a bit without even being aware of it. Believe me, I'm speaking from experience. These lessons are urging us to draw closer to God, to be mindful of our human, sinful limitations, the ways that we attempt to use status, power, or influence to get what we want, over and above the needs of others. Jesus reminds us that our status, what we are as people, is not as important to God as getting help and love shown to others. As we celebrate our ministry here at Zion this past year in our annual meeting coming up after worship, we remember that Zion is typically a place of welcome for others. We've had a challenging past 18 months or so. We closed a while back for in-person worship and activities. We've been open for these things with many good protocols in place after planning and implementing. And we've been working in the midst of great uncertainty to provide a stable, safe, welcoming place to worship our Lord. In the continuing uncertainty of this pandemic, we continue to welcome all people and have opened ourselves up for worship, trusting in God's leading and grace. In the midst of uncertainty and fear, there is Jesus. He's been leading and guiding us with the Holy Spirit to bring us through difficult times, to lead us into the future, healthy and strong. It's my hope that you have taken time to reflect on your relationship with Jesus during those past 18 months. In times of uncertainty or fear, trauma, it's natural to turn to Jesus in prayer and ask for help. These times can help us to grow in faith and lead us to reach out to others in love and care. There's an edginess in the book of James, an edginess that reminds us that we are all in this together. We're all called to work on our personal relationship with God as we work on loving and caring others. In his grace and love, Jesus is always waiting for us, watching, calling out for us to draw near to him, that we might draw others to his saving grace. So how How do we come to know God better? How do we get closer to God? A book that I like that I've read is called Christian Faith, The Basics. And it's by a pastor, Walt Kallestad. And in one of the chapters he wrote, it's called How Can I Know God? He wrote a little story. He said, a young woman said to me, this man lived in the same building with me, so I knew that he existed. And on a particular Saturday, I could have walked right through the door that he held open for me and gone on my way. But if I had, I would never have come to know the man I've loved and called my husband for 26 years. Kallestad goes on to write, how many times has a pattern and quality of your life changed because you took the time to stop and get to know someone? And the same holds true for God. We can know of God, but that's not really the same as knowing God. I believe when we open ourselves up to God and Jesus by sharing our inmost thoughts and feelings, by asking him to work in our lives and shape and mold us into the person he wants us to be, we come to know God in the way that Kallestad was talking about. We come to know God in Jesus and draw near to him as we acknowledge our sins and realize that it's only through the grace and mercy of Christ that we are able to call ourselves children of God. It's like children that we come begging for God's grace and knowing that we will receive it. Amen.
Friends.
Please rise. Let us confess together our common faith through the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. Again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. Welcome to all of you this morning, especially to our visitors. There is a fellowship time after worship today, so please take note of that, and there will be time for fellowship before the annual meeting begins. So come on back, have some coffee and lemonade and goodies. As I said, there's the annual meeting today for both the foundation and the congregation, so please take part in that. And there is a kickoff for the Sunday school at the same time after worship in God's Acres. On Monday at 9 o'clock, the church is going to start smelling really good again because we got lefse making for the fall supper coming up. So it's going to be good. And 9 o'clock on Monday. Is there anything we need to know about that? Come and help and roll out and do all those good things. We have the fall supper coming up on Wednesday. And if you are not aware, there are things that are different about it this year. And they have different seatings. And that's listed in your bulletin. And there's a sign-up sheet in the narthex for you. You can buy tickets, you can get the place setting that you want. Judy, is there anything we need to know about? The what?
5:15 seating is full.
Okay, 5:15 is full. 4 and 6:30, okay. Okay, so the office will take reservations.
We also need some more workers, so
check out. Okay, great. Thanks. A couple notes that we need to be aware of, reminding us that we really are no abiding city on this earth. One of our dear members from the past, two of our dear members have passed away. Denise Holmgren was a member here for many years and then moved to Henning after her husband David died. And her service, she had died, and her service was yesterday at Grace Lutheran in Henning. Bev Brandt also passed away this past Thursday. Keith's wife, and their funeral will be this coming week. Her funeral will be this coming week in Burnsville at Prince of Peace. On Friday at 3 o'clock, there will be a service here for David Bope, the brother of Rob Bope and Sue Sethry, and that will be a private service, so keep the family in your thoughts and your prayers at this time. Are there any other announcements we need to be aware of? Yeah. I like people with energy. Look at her go.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to let you know, if you haven't heard yet, starting September 27th, it's going to be not this Monday, but next Monday, I'm going to be starting a Tai Chi Chuan class. And so
say that slower.
Tai Chi Chuan.
Okay.
It's like Tai Chi, except it's focused on helping us prevent falls and prevent the hospitalization rates from falls. So it's going to be an hour-long class. There's 24 sessions. We'll meet twice a week. If you want to come, check it out. I'll be happy to see happy faces there. It's going to be on Monday from 8 to 9 a.m., and then the second day a week will be Thursdays from 7 to 8 p.m. So it is a progressive course, so to make everything is going to be helpful, but if one or the other works best for you, it's always better to have some rather than nothing, I think. So come talk to me after church or whenever if you have more questions or want to get signed up for it. And I hope to see as many people there as we can. So thank you.
Thanks, Jessica. Let's continue with our worship. Our offering.
We lift our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our lives up to you, we are an offering. Lord, use our voices, Lord, use our hands, Lord, use our lives, they are yours, we are an offering. All that we have, all that we are, all that we hope to be, we give to you, we give to you. We lift our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our up to you, we are an offering, we are an offering. We lift our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our lives up to you, we are an offering. Lord, use our voices, Lord, use our hands, Lord, use our lives, they are yours, we are an offering. All that we have, all that we are, all that we hope to be, we give. We lift our voices.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, in Jesus your Son, we come together to hear your word and to ask for your forgiveness. We have heard your call to be disciples, and yet we hesitate. Give us courage, openness to others, and peace in our lives as we work for your kingdom, Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, as we gather for our annual meetings today, I give thanks for this congregation and their faithfulness this past year. Zion is blessed with people who care and people who give of themselves to your ministry. As we move forward, lead and guide us with your Holy Spirit, that we might continue to grow in grace and reach out to our friends and neighbors here and across the world. Lord, in your mercy, God of healing and love, we pray for your healing power and comfort for those who are dealing with health concerns. Comfort and protect those who are waiting for tests, for treatment, or for knowledge of their future. Bless all who are recovering from surgeries, waiting for healing, and struggling with pain. Grant recovery and hope, grace and blessing. And we remember especially today Dave Willey, Morgan Sandy, Tim Wing, Todd Pulford, Barbara Biorgo, Mark Wing, Kevin Foss, Jim Rood, Wilma Herring, Carol Gilo, Barbara Biorgo, and all those that we name before you in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we pray for little Piper Yackley as she begins life a little earlier than expected. Bless her parents, Bailey and Danny, with comfort, peace, and hope. Help them to know of your love and presence in their lives. Lord, in your mercy. Be with our nation as we deal with so many difficult crises. We pray for those still caught in turmoil of Afghanistan, for the migrants coming to our southern border. With all the concerns, we pray for peace and a positive resolution. Give our leaders wisdom, understanding, compassion, and courage to do what is your will and what is best for our country. Lord, in your mercy. Be present with those who struggle with the loss of loved ones. We remember especially the Bope family as they prepare for David's funeral, for the Holmgren family as they deal with Denise's death, and for the Brants as they look to the funeral for Bev this coming week. Bless and help ease their sorrow and grief with a promise of new life in the kingdom of heaven. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sinned against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The ushers will assist you to the table.
Thank you.
The precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace and peace unto eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
We will.
You are King.